Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Brass and Unity, One Woman's Journey Through the Hell of Afghanistan and Back, by Kelsi Sheren, narrated by Kelsi Sheren. To those with whom I've served in the darkest times so that others may live, I am grateful for you all. To my partner in all things and better half, Rue, without you, none of this would be possible. To our beautiful, curly-headed explorer of all things dirty and sticky, I'm forever grateful for you bringing me into the light and showing me what it truly means to live and love. Until Valhalla. Foreword. Courage has many meanings for many people. For our serving military personnel and my fellow veterans, it took courage to join the military. It takes courage to leave our loved ones behind, to miss birthdays, special occasions, holidays, and sometimes the birth of our children while serving our country in the pursuit of our foundational beliefs. It takes courage to serve overseas, to deal with war, the loss of our comrades, and then to return home to struggle with our injuries, wounds, losses, and memories. It especially takes courage to battle out of the darkness and the stigma that post-traumatic stress disorder, PTSD, casts on every aspect of a person's life. Kelsi has done all that her country and fellow veterans have asked of her and so much more. Many have lost their way upon their return home and have succumbed to suicide. She managed to persevere. Kelsi's story has taken courage to survive, but even more so to tell. She has detailed the day and night struggles that she and everyone suffering from PTSD, no matter what the cause, must endure in order to survive. She has given a dark voice to the terrible brain injury that is called PTSD. It is a story of courage, strength, honor, pain, distrust, and trust, coupled with unbreakable military bonds that last a lifetime. It is a powerful and emotional story of not only surviving the dark morass of PTSD, but also clawing her way out of that black hole to actually be able to live again, to be able to feel happiness, to love, to establish new friendships, a cherished family, and a life with meaning. We lose veterans to suicide every day, many of whom are never recognized as casualties of their military service. These are our unknown fallen. It has been my distinct honor to share my time, expertise, and experience with Kelsi since 2011. Her book is an absolute must-read for anyone trying to understand PTSD, cope with it, or whom want to try to make a difference and perhaps prevent more unnecessary suicides. Dr. Greg Passy, BSc, MD, CDI, FRC, PC, psychiatrist, Lieutenant Colonel, retired. Author's note. This book is for my friends and fellow veterans who've lost their lives to PTS, and for all of those vets who served overseas and did not fully come back. I've written this book to try to shed some light on the battle that I still fight today with PTS, in the hopes that my story might help save a life. This book is also intended to educate those who might not understand what it's like to be a soldier and what we endure during a deployment. I want you to know what we see when we're over there and how we feel when we get home. The truth is, all combat soldiers leave a part of themselves, or all of themselves, in a place where the dirt cuts like razors, the water doesn't flow freely, animals run wild, and the next step we take might be our last. I want regular civilians to understand what it's like to suffer from PTSD so that they might relate to someone who is currently in the throes of it. Our veteran and first responder communities are suffering every single day with PTSD, and I want average people to know what it is like for us, not being able to go out in the general public due to this crippling disorder. This book has been difficult to write. I was forced to think for way too long about the events that caused my PTSD and the friends I've lost, and I've been triggered a lot. But that's the thing about PTSD. It doesn't go away. You just have to learn how to live with it. I truly hope this book will be a learning tool or a resource or maybe a coaster on a bedside table, but as long as it helps even one person, it will all be worth it. I never thought there would be a day in my life when I would be able to say something like that. I didn't think I'd make it to this point in healing myself, let alone try to help others who are suffering too. I'm sick and tired of my friends dying by suicide, overseas, and at home. They're fighting in a war that is killing on both sides, physically and mentally affecting generations to come. The contents of this book are uncomfortable. There are some very graphic details that may not be suitable for those under the age of 16 or anyone with a weak stomach. But these things are the reality of war, and they were my reality. War doesn't leave you when you come home. Please let my story be one of hope, perseverance, and persistence, because we cannot lose any more people to this mental health crisis in our veteran and first responder communities. Please reach out to anyone you know who is struggling. Reach out and give a hand, even if that means pushing someone when he or she might not recognize the signs alone. You could be the thing, the person, the hope that saves someone's life. If you need immediate assistance, call the Veterans Crisis Hotline at 1-800-273-8255 and press 1. Chat online or send a text to 838-255 to receive confidential support 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. In the USA, the 988 Suicide and Crisis Lifeline is a national network of local crisis centers that provides free and confidential emotional support to people in suicidal crisis or emotional distress 24 hours a day, 7 days a week in the United States. I'm PTSD. Let me introduce myself. I've been called by different names over the years: combat fatigue, exhaustion, soldier's heart, shell shock, post-Vietnam syndrome. Most know me now as PTSD. I don't care what you call me. When I take you, you're mine. I've claimed the lives of Spartans and countless so-called gladiators. I take good guys, bad guys, the young and the old. And I like the strongest ones most of all because I prefer a challenge. I've been killing for as long as wars have been waged, since the advent of time. My method is simple. I mess with your head until you can't take it anymore. You learn to live with me, or you won't. Prologue. Numb. Panjwa District, Afghanistan, 0100 hours, June 2009. I step off the Chinook onto a hot, dark landing zone with 3 units of the British military. My legs are numb, as if someone is sitting on them for the entire flight. The gate opens. Everyone pushes out from the hold, and I collapse onto the metal lift, which is basically at the edge of safety and hell. My chest tightens, and my fingers clench onto the helicopter. My feet won't move, and my world goes black as I slip in and out of consciousness. Hot air from the chopper blades presses down on me, and then someone's hand digs into my back. He leans down and screams in my ear in a thick Scottish accent, "Aye, move, let's go." He lifts my whole body off the cold floor of the Chinook and pushes me out onto the Panjwa ground. The night sky keeps the heat at bay for now, almost beautiful. There is nothing, absolutely nothing, impeding the glow of the stars. It is strangely peaceful and serene. Although it's one of the most dangerous places for NATO forces to be in Afghanistan, home of the Taliban. I hear nothing and everything all at once, yet the silence only lasts a moment. The quiet evening turns to war, with the roar of the Chinook blades cutting through the air. We march onward to God knows where. My heart beats so fast in my chest and so loud, I feel as if everyone can hear it, even with all the boots crunching on the ground. There's no time to stand still. The feeling rushes back into my legs like a shot of adrenaline to the heart. As I begin to run, I quickly realize how uneven and hard the ground is and that it is likely littered with improvised explosive devices, IEDs. The dry grass whips around like we were in the middle of a twister. The Chinook tosses rocks, dirt, and sand as it gets into a new position. I pull my scarf up over my face to shield my nose and mouth from flying debris. One of the sergeants screams, "Stay with the dog handler. Just follow him and you'll be fine." Before we left for this week-long op, I was told, "We don't use female searchers, really. So we probably won't need you much." Famous last words. Part 1. Brass. 1. The start, the French. January 3rd, 2008. The drive with my parents from our home in Campbellford, Ontario, to the Canadian Forces Leadership and Recruit School and military base in Saint-Jean-sur-Richelieu on the outskirts of Quebec is a grueling 5-hour trip. Mostly, it is silent, each of us lost in our own thoughts. In the rear-view mirror, Dad's eyes watch me. They are softer than usual, and his furrowed brow doesn't lift during the entire trip. Sprawled across the back seat, all 5 feet and 104 pounds of me, my 18-year-old self ready, willing, and I hope able to become a soldier and deploy to parts unknown. I have a flashback. I can see myself at age 12, braces on my teeth, in Taekwondo class. Kelsi, shortstop, one of the girls shouts into my face. I press my hands against my ears and her words are muffled. Their mouths still move, and I can see their angry grins and arms cheering widely. I can also see myself in the dojo's large mirrors. I am flat as a board and my hair is cut short. I cut it to be more agile on the mat when I am not training. I place large headphones over my cropped hair and listen to Eminem spit vitriol as I plan my next fight. I look down from the mirror, trying not to face any of the images confronting me. Hands slam against my shoulders, pushing me toward a group circling around me. I stumble forward to a raw cry of tinsel teeth in unison. A shove in the other direction, tin grin, I step back. But the pushing doesn't stop. My legs give way, but I stand up straight and run toward the crowd. One boy lunges forward. "You're too weak, zipper lips." And he rips off my beloved tearaway pants. I clench my fists. This is what my long hours on the Taekwondo mats are for. To move quickly. To bring down an opponent twice my size. I strike with one fist. And as his body flies backwards, the group steps away from me. I walk away so they don't see my tears. Biting my lips so hard, my braces cut my skin. I didn't train to fight bullies. I'm better than that. But if I have to, so be it. I can show any doubters that I'm not as small and weak as I look. 6 years later, the Army recruiter who accepted my application wanted to know why a shortstop like me was so eager to put myself in harm's way. Of course, I told him that I wanted to serve my country. There was another part of me, however, that knew I was still the same little girl fighting in Taekwondo class, eager to prove that despite my appearance, I was strong, a perfect candidate for the Army. Now I am on my way to make good on both of those promises. I lean against the car window, enough to see my mom's profile as she stares at the passing scenery. For a moment, her strong jawline quivers and her words from last night replay in my mind. "I always suspected you might join the military one day." Whether or not she agrees with the decision, I'll never know, but that's mom. She has always been my rock. She sacrificed everything and gave up her job to stay home when my brother and I were kids. How many times did I call home crying because someone was bullying me or because I forgot to bring a lunch to school? No matter what she was doing, she would drop everything for Dylan and I. How did she do all of that and still manage to put dinner on the table every night? My parents have made us their entire life, and now I'm going to be so far away. For the first months of my training, I won't even be able to call my parents. I've never been out of touch with them for such a long period, even with Dad being a long-haul trucker for my entire childhood. No matter how far away he was, he called us from the road almost every night to see what we were up to, and he was home as often as he could be. We park outside a big concrete institutional building with tiny windows, the place where I'll be living for the next few weeks. When we get out of the car, the wind smacks me in the face, my eyes water, and my nose starts to run. Mom's long blonde hair tosses around her head, and the wind grabs the long gray whiskers on Dad's chin and lifts the ball cap off his balding head. Somehow, they look older, wearier, but they are by my side, stone-faced and strong, here for me, now like they've always been. We all look at the soldiers running around the building. Some of them are in green uniforms and boots. Others are in shorts, sweaters, toques, and sneakers. While some look happy, others look like they might collapse. None of them look at me. I turn back toward my parents as I shield my eyes from the sun. Mom opens and closes her mouth, but no words come out. We can see our breath, and the air smells like snow. They aren't allowed past this point, so I give Mom a hug, and when she lets go, wiping her tears, Dad puts his arms around me. With his beard on my cheek, his voice cracks as he manages his usual farewell. See ya, kid. Love ya. He said these words to me many times before leaving in his big rig. I don't show them how nervous I am, because I don't want them to worry about me being away any more than they have to. They head back to the car, leaving me with a rugby bag that's bigger than I am, which, at my size, doesn't take much. Heaving the bag up over my shoulder, I enter the building where shouts and loud footsteps echo in the hallway. Young men in starched and pressed uniforms march past me, swinging stiff arms, facing forward with stern expressions, and pressing syncopated boot heels into the floor. What the hell did I sign up for? After a few minutes, I figure out where I'm supposed to be, and a big, solid-looking man pulls me into a classroom. I soon learn he's a sergeant. He tells me, "Put down your bag, find the envelope with your name on it, then sit down and shut up." "Yes, sir." "What did you call me?" he barks as he leans into my flushed face. Now I know rule number one, never, ever call a sergeant, sir. The other members of my troop pile into the classroom. Their shoes squeak on the floor, and they're all frantically trying to find their names on the envelopes so that the sergeant doesn't yell at them. His voice booms over the chaos. "Read everything inside the envelope, sign where indicated, and then climb the 9 flights of stairs with your bags up to your pod and do it fast." I now consider throwing out my bag. Rule number two, pack lightly. We race upstairs as quickly as we can and start to settle into the cramped dorm-like place, and through sheer luck, I have a small room to myself. My troop is mostly guys, with maybe 6 women. I try to make small talk with them, but none of them seem interested in chatting. Either they're as nervous as I am, or they're not interested in befriending me. Some people go to bed right away, while others unpack. I choose to finish the homework in the envelope because I don't want to piss off the red-faced sergeant. The instructions are, in a few pages, describe why you joined the military, what made you decide on the trade you chose, and a little bit about yourself. Snow pelts against the window, and I stare into the dark evening before I start writing, remembering the moment that prompted me to join the Army. My name is Kelsi Burns. I joined the Army because I want to prove to all of the assholes from my small town that I'm not weak just because I'm small. I am joining the Army because I am looking for a place to belong, where my physical abilities will count for something, because I want to help people, because I don't know what else I can do after my coach ruined my plans for the future by making a stupid decision that broke my trust and shattered my dreams. I tear the paper out and crumple it up. I have to sound tough, like a soldier would, so I start again. My name is Kelsi Burns. I'm 18 years old, and my parents are truck drivers who live in Campbellford, Ontario. My brother Dylan and I used to drive cross-country in the cab with my dad. I love seeing Canada, and I loved traveling. I always knew there was more out there for me than Campbellford, and joining the Army, to me, equals freedom and a chance to see the world. I was bullied the whole time I was in school, both physically and verbally. I don't know a time when I wasn't bullied for something. People pushed me around and told me I was weak. I've always felt the need to fight and prove myself tougher than everyone else, because I'm small. I was told I couldn't do things because of my size, so I always tried my best to prove that I could. My parents always pushed me to work hard, and they made me believe I can do anything I want if I put in the effort. I'm thankful they made me so strong. When I was 4 years old, my mother signed me up for Taekwondo, and I fell in love with it. I lived and breathed it, trained and fought competitively for 8 years. I even taught classes. I earned my black belt when I was 11 years old. I learned who I was on those mats. I found determination and spirit and passion, and I planned to be a professional athlete. When I found out that my coach made a very stupid decision that jeopardized my training and hurt a lot of people, I was angry for a long time. I lost my ability to trust, and I lost my future thanks to his poor decision. Without Taekwondo, I found it hard to get through high school. My friend, Lisa Gawley, introduced me to rugby, which was a great way to get out anger. Rugby was filling my time, but it wasn't making me happy. I couldn't wait to get out of high school and to leave Campbellford. I went to college in Ottawa just to get away. I was accepted into a travel and tourism program that I didn't care about, and I was struggling, feeling like I had no purpose. On Remembrance Day last November, I went to a service in Ottawa, and on my way home, I chatted with an older female veteran on the bus. I can't explain why, but I felt like I was supposed to meet her. She told me about her experience being a pilot in the Air Force, and I thought she was amazing. I decided that even though I didn't know anything about the military, it sounded like a good career for me. I went to a recruitment center and spoke with a representative. He told me about the camaraderie that I would find in the armed forces and how great a career it would be. Finally, I felt like I found the thing that would make me happy, where my strengths would be valued and where I could form true friendships. I'm excited to be training to become an artillery gunner. I joined the Army because I want to help people and to serve my country. I want to be part of something meaningful, and I want to make my parents proud. I chose artillery because I respect the power of weapons and because I was told I'm too small to be infantry. I love the thought of being able to protect my unit by being behind the guns if I can't be on the front lines. I joined the Army because, well, I feel like I've been training to fight my whole life. I scratch things out and rewrite the answers about three times. When I finally finish writing, my stomach is growling, and I march to the meal hall. Halfway down the corridor, an officer monitoring at a stopwatch stands beside a soldier on the floor holding plank. He yells at a group of us marching by, "Does everybody see what happens when you're caught walking instead of marching?" The guy in plank looks like he's in serious pain. His unit marches around him in support, and I join them and ask, "How long has he been there?" 10 minutes so far. "For not marching?" "Yep." "If you don't want to be that guy, you better march, no matter what." Rule number three. The long tables, noisy chatter, and clink of utensils in the meal hall make me feel like I'm back in high school, deciding whom to sit with. "Hi, I'm Kelsi." I slide my tray into the last spot at a full table. "Hey," says the guy across from me. "Your first night?" says another. "You can tell." They all laugh. "You didn't get your meal card punched," adds a girl further down. "If you don't, you get in trouble. They want to make sure you're eating three meals a day." "Thanks." That's rule number four. I take a big bite of my pizza. It's a favorite around here, and I won't have an issue punching my card today. "Where'd you go to school?" asks the guy next to me. "St. Mary's Secondary and Campbellford District High School. You?" "Guelph University." "So why'd you join?" I ask him. "Piss off my parents. I'm infantry. You?" "Artillery." A guy across from me smirks. "I'm Navy." A young guy with a buzz cut calls out, "Go Army, beat Navy." Another guy stands up and stacks his food tray. "Have fun sleeping in the mud and throwing up over the side of a boat. Air Force tops all of you." "Army beats Navy. Dirty seaman." Everyone starts to laugh. The teasing and trash talking puts me at ease. It's been less than 24 hours and already I'm connecting with people, just like the Armed Forces rep told me would happen. The quiet in my dorm made me uncomfortable, but now I feel I'm in the right place and that I made the right decision. Later, when I enter my room, in the silence among strangers, apprehension returns. I wonder what tomorrow has in store for me. By the time I crawl into my cot, underneath stiff, starched sheets and an itchy wool blanket, I'm excited and terrified at the same time. A pounding on the door wakes me. A collective groan sweeps across the entire room, but I can't even make a sound yet. I hear some yelling in the distance and hope the racket stops so I can doze off again. Our main door is kicked open. "Get up!" With one eye open, I look at the time. I'm a morning person, but 0400 comes real early when you're not ready for it. There's screaming and yelling from the hallway, then loud footsteps. "Get out! Get out!" I haven't been out of bed this early since I was training for my black belt. And suddenly, I'm thankful for those 8 years of early morning practices. I roll out of bed as a sergeant marches towards my end of the room. Move it! Down the stairs! Now! My whole troop exits like a stream of fish toward the door, where people are tripping over their feet, pushing into the hall, and rumbling down the stairs. On the main floor, there's a semblance of calm and a chorus of yawns as we stand obediently in a line. Half of us aren't fully awake as the sergeant paces in front of us. It's time for physical training, PT. Every morning from now on, you'll be ready at 0400. I'm not your mommy coming to wake you. He glares down the line, and I'm sure his eyes pause on me for a moment. You are to be fed, dressed, downstairs, and waiting together in two perfect lines. If one of you is late, or you're down here with unpolished boots, everyone is treated to an extra round of push-ups or an extra mile outside in the cold. His voice hardens. There will be consequences. Rule number 5. One person screws up, we all screw up, and we will all pay for it together. Maybe the only rule that really matters. February 2008. There's something peaceful about running in the early morning when your feet crunch in the snow, your breath rises in the frosty air, and your nose hairs freeze in the cold. I'm the first of the girls to finish the 10K run, and I could easily do another 5K. But it's time to march to breakfast before getting cleaned up and ready for inspection. I've been an athlete my entire life, and the physical challenges here are nothing new to me. Black belts don't come for free. Give me more running, more push-ups, more sit-ups, more chin-ups, the biggest sandbags. Give me a heavier kit. Push me harder. I know it isn't a competition, and we need to be training as a unit, but this stuff comes naturally to me. I was built for it. We're now 6 weeks into training, and some people have dropped out. I've tried helping some of my troop, but they don't want it. So while we're here to be stronger together than apart, I also make it my mission to be stronger than anyone else. I'm the smallest person here, but that is nothing new to me either. This is just another challenge, and thanks to Mom and Dad drilling it in my head that I can do anything if I work hard enough, I'm mentally prepared to deal with it. At meal hall, I walk toward an empty seat at a table with a blonde girl from my room, but she quickly puts her jacket on the seat. I'll admit, I thought making friends would be easier than this. I continue to another table where the rest of the girls from my room are, and I sit down with my tray. Hi. They don't even look at me, so I dig into my eggs, bacon, and toast, barely chewing. Their behavior reminds me of a rugby tournament in Florida, and I'm transported back to my high school days. Check out mine. One of the girls on my team passes around her new ID to the rest of my teammates while I stare out the window at the palm trees whizzing by. While I'm hoping the last gravel I took, which is a medication I use to treat and prevent motion sickness, as well as nausea, vomiting, and dizziness, will hold me until we get to the hotel. All they can think of is partying. Oh my God, yours totally looks real. I can't believe we didn't get caught, whispers one of them. I know, last night was epic. I'm away from my parents for the first time, and while I was sleeping last night to be rested for the upcoming games, they all snuck out of the hotel to get belly button piercings and fake IDs. I am so ready to graduate and get out of Campbellford. These girls accept me because I score for the team, but I will never be one of them. It doesn't feel a lot different here. Maybe I should try harder, but I'm not sure what to do. I'll ask Mom about it when I see her and Dad in a couple of days. Everything seemed so new and promising at the beginning of basic, but it's been a long 6 weeks. I don't want to burden Mom, since I know it'll be a long drive for my parents to get here, but I just can't wait to talk to people who genuinely like me. I need this visit. I look up at my troop with another attempt. I'm starving after PT. Gonna show us up in eating too? One of the girls snares. I'll just go bang out 25 chin-ups in a row. I've been doing them since I was a kid in martial arts. I can show you a trick that works for me. I offer. But instead of accepting my gesture, they turn their attention to a bunch of guys at the next table that are joking around. One of the guys is turning into a goddamn super soldier, which, frankly, pisses me off. His marching is smoother, his beret is shaped better, his boots are shinier, his rifle is perfect, his PT is on point, and he crushes the social game of BMQ, Basic Military Qualification Life. I want to be him, calm, cool, collected, but the women treat me like I'm a bitch. The seat beside the blonde is still empty. Clearly, she was giving me a message. Despite my efforts, things aren't getting any better. In fact, the tenser the training gets, the more tired and stressed everyone is, the less I'm making friends. The BS I thought I left in high school followed me to college and here too, apparently. Anyway, I'm training for my career, not to win a popularity contest. So the hell with them. Part of me actually enjoyed the shit talking. It meant that they viewed me as strong, and it gave me fuel to wipe the floor with them. After breakfast, I marched to my room. I'm going to make good and sure my chore is done perfectly, because I don't feel like holding a push-up position for a half hour or getting us grounded this weekend. The floors are already clean enough to eat off of, but I scrub again anyway. When I enter the bathroom, I see a drip trailing from the bar of soap into the sink. What's going on? Nobody has started to clean in here yet. I step out of the room. Hey, it's almost time for inspection. Which of you is on bathroom today? Oh, we're not doing it. One of them removes a clump of hair from her brush and watches it drop onto the floor. You have to. I remind her, we will lose our Saturday if we don't pass inspection. And the week before was the first time we were allowed to leave since getting here. Exactly, they chime in. We'll all get in trouble if it's not done. So you'll do it, Burns. There's no point in fighting with them. I'm the teenager here. And it's the 30 and 40-year-old women I'm living with who are acting like children. They're right. They don't care. And they know I'll do it. With a glare, I pick up her hair from the floor, turn, and rush back to the bathroom. All the while, they're laughing at me. 6 more weeks of this. 6 more weeks. While I'm finishing the floors, scrubbing the toilet, and rinsing the sink, I focus on getting a bear hug from Dad, seeing Mom smile, and telling them about my training. There are so many things I can't wait to share, like swim training, and how much fun it is to tread water in full uniform, including boots, holding weights. Everyone better have their shit together for inspection so we get our weekend. I do a quick check around the pod and make sure everything's inspection ready, then hurry back to my bunk. I open my drawers, everything's in place. My socks have been painstakingly rolled and folded into one another like little wool envelopes. I check my bed for the proper 45-degree angle folds in the sheets. My boots are shined, my rifle is clean, everything else on my mental checklist seems to be good. I want to smack the others, but I'm good. The sergeant's boots thump as he enters our pod, so I adjust my feet, quickly check that my hair is tucked under my beret, and stand at attention. A breath of relief comes from everyone as he leaves our room. We're cleared. But in a few minutes, I hear him yelling from the next room. Our staff is always yelling, but yelling during inspection is bad. I hear a thud and more yelling. Someone got their pod flipped. I take a deep breath and count to 10 to stop myself from screaming. We just lost our Saturday. And now I have to spend the day with my unit doing more drills instead of hanging out with my parents. I lean against the wall and close my eyes to fight back the tears. My roommates are laughing. Ah, poor little Burns misses her mommy and daddy. One of them jeers. But thanks for cleaning the bathroom. You can do it again tomorrow. A lump rises in my throat. I've never missed my parents like this, and now I have to call them and say I can't see them this weekend. They came all this way for nothing. An hour later, we're standing outside in rows of 4 for bayonet rifle training. All I can hear is the disappointed sounds of my parents' voices, and my anger grows. I get the point. One of us messes up, everyone suffers, but I'm still pissed off. Following orders precisely is a critical lesson when you're preparing for war. A pencil out of place on a desk is a preventable error. They told us how to do it, and we have to do what they say. One preventable mistake in combat equals death. One person makes a little blunder, everyone dies. After a few hours, I'm chilled to the bone, even though I'm in my full winter uniform, thermal underwear, thermal undershirt, polar fleece pants, polar fleece shirt, combat toque, combat parka, parka bib pants, gloves, wool socks, and muckluck boots. The snow has started melting, but the ground is frozen and icy. I can barely feel my feet. I bring my rifle to my chest for the millionth time today as we wait for the order. Fix bayonet! A succession of clicks rings out as we unsheath our bayonets. Sun glinting off the metal blades, snapping them in place on our rifles. I no longer have to use my brain for this drill. My muscles know what to do, and this is what they want. I step forward and lunge, rifle extended. Step back, forward march. Bring the rifle to my side, again and again. I stand back up, screaming, "Kill!" And with everyone else, I jab my rifle into the dummy's chest, neutralizing the enemy. Who the enemy is or where we will be facing him someday, I don't know, but we're told this training may save our lives. The Watcher. Hello, Kelsi. You haven't met me yet, but you will. And I already know everything about you. I've been logging details about your life since you almost died in the womb. No wonder you're always so worried about doing things wrong. You couldn't even be born right. Fun fact, the bullying will never stop for you. That's what happens when you're weak. 2. Training. February 2008. My feet sink into the deep snow on our march into Farnham training camp. I keep pace as we trudge together in two lines, fully kitted up for a week outside the wire. It's our first training session beyond the confines of the secure military base. As we grind our way against a strong wind, I adjust my rucksack and push through the discomfort of carrying my own body weight while slogging in the snow. Farnham is the camp near Garrison, used for field exercises. And we're promised a week-long adventure that involves sub-zero camping, sleep deprivation, reconnaissance missions on foot, and a timed 13K ruck march. I keep my eyes peeled, watching for any signs of the enemy hiding in the trees, knowing we could be ambushed at any time. "Why do you seem so paranoid, Burns?" one of the guys behind me shouts. "Staff is watching us like hawks and evaluating us," I call out, "right now, even when cleaning our kit." "Not when we're sleeping and eating," he laughs. "I'm looking forward to sentry duty. You?" QRF. I can't wait for quick reaction force. The rest of this week is going to suck, but we're almost done. We reach a clearing in the woods with a cluster of little wooden sheds and break up into groups of 8. "I want to be one of the snipers," says the guy with a lisp. "So, my brother did this," adds the tattooed guy with a knowing grin, lots of walking the fence of the compound, watching the gate, sitting up in the tower, and looking out for any signs of suspicious activity. "Can't imagine having more fun," chimes another. "They just want you to obey every order." The tattooed guy snaps his heels together. "March, clean, shoot, eat, sleep," he points at us. "Obey, don't question, and you stay alive." "Where's your brother deployed to now?" "Afghanistan." "It's brutal there," I heard. The guy with the lisp opens the door to the shelter. My brother says no amount of training prepared him for it. That you can't imagine unless you've been there. "But it's helping the people there, right?" asks another. "Yeah, but it's no peace mission. My brother says the Taliban is everywhere. It's full on war." I follow the group into the shelter, wondering what actual war will be like. The sweet scent of chipboard greets us. I can see my breath and a thin layer of ice on the window. The moment I sit down on the cot, my heavy rucksack slides off my back. This pack contains everything I'll need, from underwear, air mattress, and sleeping bag, to a gas mask, helmet, and a flashlight. When my face has thawed enough for me to speak, I ask, "Did your brother say if we get one good night's sleep?" He shakes his head, and before he can fully answer, above the muffled sound of the roaring wind, we hear, "Mealtime!" "Tonight's the last hot meal," one of the guys says, grinning ear to ear. "Yeah," another nods. "Tomorrow, it's good old bomb-proof ration packs." "I don't mind rations," adds the tattooed guy. "Some of them are actually pretty good." "Any idea who the enemy is in the simulations?" asks another. "My brother said you never know." And it doesn't matter. Our lives could be snuffed out at any point. And it could be by a kid, a woman, a man. We kill them and protect each other. That's all that matters in war. After supper, as I burrow into my sleeping bag, I think about his brother's comment. If this was real, and I was now deployed with these seven guys, our lives would depend on each other. I'm in my cot, fully dressed except for my boots, ready to show them they can count on me. I bolt awake about an hour after lights out, to banging, yelling, and the whistle pop of gunfire. Game time. We scramble out of our cots and into our boots. What did I tell you? The guy with the lisp shouts through his hood. We grab our weapons and race outside to the gates of our makeshift base, breaking up into our troops of four, hunched against the strong wind while getting into position. I'm both exhilarated and exhausted, but glad that I went to bed in my combat parka. Even though my teeth chatter and my feet ache, my old friend adrenaline is alive and slowly warming me up. Adrenaline. There's a little flaw in your training here. They keep warning you about the enemy, but when you're faced with the Taliban, they won't be holding up signs or wearing badges to identify themselves. Every single person with brown skin is someone who might kill you. You'll find that out soon enough when you're done playing pretend war. February 2008. The next morning, I choke down sausage and hash browns from a brown envelope before we hit the range for our shooting lesson. Rations taste amazing when you're exhausted and hungry. Pulling my toque down tighter on my head, I cover my ears against the cold and the sound of the rifles firing downrange. I shuffle my feet to send some warmth into my body until, finally, it's my turn to shoot. Moving quickly, we trade our hats for helmets and put on our eye protection. My boots crunch in the snow as I take my place at the platform. As I lift the gun, my hands tremble. I signed up to be an artillery gunner, and I've never fired a weapon before. Narrowing my eyes on the target I'm aiming for. I follow the officer's instructions, racking the weapon, pulling the buttstock against my right shoulder, right hand on the trigger, left hand on the barrel. Nervous energy runs through me as I look into the sight of the rifle and line up for my shot. Staff is on the lookout to see which of us might make a good sniper. I'm just hoping to hit the target. I pull the trigger and the bullet charges down the range. A brass casing flies out behind me and I hit my target. The power in that shot sends a jolt of excitement through me as the scent of fresh gunpowder lingers in my nose. I continue to shoot and each time it's less intimidating. One of the other girls here, Sarah Lynn, gets the marksmanship awards. She's badass and I'm proud of her. After she's named the winner, I approach her. Hey, congratulations, you did awesome. Thanks, you did great too. I'll take pointers from you anytime. I pull my hat tighter. You're on. I heard you're a black belt, so show me a thing or two. Anytime, but right now I'm starving. Want to eat lunch together? Sarah Lynn nods as we walk to a quieter area. We rip into our rations, both of us too hungry to talk or even care about what we're eating. Which trade are you? I gulp down my last bite. Navy, she manages between mouthfuls. I want to be a medic. Cool, I'm Army, artillery gunner. Battle drills and formations are next. She shuffles her feet to warm up. You'll ace that one. By the end of the day, I'm mentally and physically exhausted from the amount of activity my body has been through, the new information I'm taking in, and the lack of sleep. My feet are soaking wet. And my heels are starting to blister from rubbing against my boots. I maneuver into my sleeping bag and close my eyes, looking forward to a bit of rest for my brain and my body. I'm almost asleep when the door flies open with the sergeant screaming, "Get out of bed, now!" We pull our boots on as we jump out of bed. "Do you all think this is a joke?" He's pacing around the room, knocking over chairs. "Do you understand what happens if someone falls asleep when they aren't supposed to? People fucking die. Someone in your unit fell asleep during their 2-hour sentry duty shift. And now you all pay. Get your rifles and start running." We dash into the darkness, slip sliding in the ice-cold rain. He's not wrong. If you sleep when you're responsible for watching and protecting your entire unit, the enemy will be watching and they'll wipe you all out. People will die. Your people. The people you train with, work with, become family with. "I hate Sarge," says the guy with the lisp. "Exactly what they want," yells the tattooed guy as he runs past us. "Break you down emotionally and physically." I run after him, away from all the bitching and moaning. When you make a mistake like that, you can't take it back. We run and run and run until people start dropping like flies, and the staff can see we've been pushed hard enough. We're sent back to bed. But we're woken up 20 minutes later by another kick at the door. "QRF on me." I jump up, scramble to my feet, grab my weapon, and race out the door. Finally, it's QRF time. This is where things get fun as we learn what it will be like in an actual war zone. Gunfire rings out in the pitch black, and I run with my unit toward the sound. There's a flash in the dark, the muzzle of an enemy's rifle, and we all duck into a ditch for cover. Rain pours down around my helmet, and I shiver as I unclip my night vision goggles and put them on. Everything looks green, but at least I'm not completely blind out here in the dark. My blood pumps hard, pushing adrenaline through my veins. We have no idea what we're running into, and I love it. This is what we will face in war, and this is the training that will count. These are the drills we hope are good enough to keep us alive. In an instant, we're overrun by the enemy. They're running around soaking wet, dressed in jeans and flannel shirts, with masks on, riot gear to mimic what we may face in guerrilla warfare. My unit rushes forward, shouting and screaming. No sooner do I grab one than he hits me in the abdomen. I see the second blow coming. No way am I going to let the enemy win. I strike first, grip his hands behind his back, and push him forcefully to his knees. "Gas, gas, gas! Shit!" I tie the guy's hands together and unclip the bag containing my protective gear from my belt. Quickly, I pull on my gas mask and climb into my suit before dragging my prisoner into the barn, where we are corralling them for their protection. I run into the darkness, pummel another enemy, and haul him over to the barn. "Burns, are you using too much force?" the guy with the lisp calls out. "He's the enemy," I bark back. "We're under attack," shouts the tattooed guy as he shoves his prisoner ahead. "We don't have time to debate right and wrong. You're here to protect your troop and gun down the enemy." He pushes his prisoner into the barn. That's what soldiers do. He's right. The enemy isn't giving up. And if this was war, and it was down to hand-to-hand combat, the outcome of losing would be death. I have never lost well. February 2008. I swear to God, I will never take dry feet for granted again. On kilometer 8 million of our 13-kilometer ruck march, my heavy pack feels like 500, and we're not allowed to run. However, we can do the airborne shuffle, dragging your feet in basically a light jog, and I'm an expert at that. Me and my little legs. I land strangely on my left foot, and a little reminder of pain shoots through the bones. Suddenly, my mind takes me back to Taekwondo class. I'm crumpled on the mat, a man standing over me. My foot burns. I felt it crack. I don't want to look at it. The man pokes and prods me. Is he a doctor? Maybe. Whoever he is, whatever he's doing, it hurts. He's saying words, but I'm not listening. All I can think about is my black belt. "Ouch," he mumbles an apology and gets up to talk to coach. I'm only halfway through day one of the two-day testing. I know my patterns and I can pass this part. I'm not worried about tomorrow, either the sparring and the self-defense. But I need my feet. I scan the gym and watch my friends going through their patterns. Each time I hear the snapping of their dough box, I hate them all. My goal is to get my black belt before I turn 12, and I want it today. I can't let someone else in my club get theirs before me. Mom plops a bag of ice on my feet. Everything will be okay. Coach ambles toward us. I hope he has good news. Everything he says to me, I take as gospel. When he speaks, It's like God is talking directly to me. I'll do what he says. I always do. So, Kelsi, you broke one foot and injured the other. No, what now? Mom asks. You have two choices. Nationals are around the corner, and you're fighting for the championship there. You don't need a black belt for that. You can either stop now and wait until you heal to test again, or freeze spray and tape your feet and go for it. My feet are swelling up and one's turning blue. I turn to Mom. What should we do? She shrugs. You have to decide, kiddo. I'm not going to be the reason you don't get your belt or why you can't fight at nationals. The ice has numbed my foot, but the second I try to wiggle my toes, pain shoots straight to my ankle. I have the rest of today to get through.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.